Hello, my name is Philip Eriksson.
And my name is Anne-Sophie Mongeau.
And you are listening to
the Sound Architect Podcast.
But I'm in charge of the nail now.
Okay, okay. Just be careful.
This is so satisfying.
Hello, and welcome to the Sound Architect Podcast. I am your host, Sam Hughes, and today I am very excited. As you just heard, I am joined by Philip Eriksson and Anne-Sophie Mongeau of Hazelight, who are going to be talking to me today about It Takes Two. Hello, how's it going?
It's going really well, thank you.
It's good. It's all good.
Excellent. Well, it's a pleasure to have you on the show. Thanks for joining me today. So I don't even know where to start, but before we dive into the game itself, would you mind just briefly introducing yourselves and what your role was on the game?
Yeah. So my role is a lead sound designer. So I am taking care of most things and have quite a lot of responsibility when it comes to the audio work, everything including VO, music and sound effects at Hazelight. Having a lot of discussions with different leads and planning the project, but also making sound effects and helping out on VO and music as well.
And my role was a senior sound designer. So that means that my workload is dedicated pretty much 100% to sound effects making and implementation. Of course, with the help and support of the rest of the team who all have their specialties in the team. We have a technical sound designer, an audio programmer, a VO designer, and even two composers. So it's really teamwork. So yeah.
It Takes Two has been a lot about teamwork from the start.
And it takes more than two, right? How big was that team?
So we actually started out with pretty much just me and Gustav Gräfberg, one of the composers. And that was about 2 years ago. And we started basically building up the team from that. So quickly we hired Joachim, our technical sound designer, and Anne-Sophie joined as well. And then we have just kind of grown and grown and grown. So right now we are 6 people in the team at Hazelight. But during the production, we had another contractor sound designer, Anders Nilsson. And we also worked with an external composer, Christopher Eng. And we also worked together with a studio in Stockholm called Red Pipe on cutscenes mostly.
Nice. So first of all, I have to say I'm very jealous because it looks like it must have been so much fun, especially from a sound design perspective. It's a complete playground, right?
Definitely. From the beginning, when we got pitched the game, when we joined on the project, on the Hazelight team, we were thinking, wow, this is really a sound designer's dream project. It's scary because there's a lot to do. There's a lot of variety. And we wished we had more time, but in the end, it turned out pretty good. And so in the beginning, we were super excited about all these prospects and all these cool sounds that we were going to make.
Yeah, definitely. And it's funny how you say you wish you had more time. It's the classic, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Always.
I mean, we managed to get it out the door, but we were really constantly under time pressure with this entire project. But it's also been a lot of fun, you know. Stress can also be, you know, in some sort of way good sometimes to just throw yourself out there and make these sounds and get the tasks done.
Definitely. And when you say there was so much variety, that was one of the first things that hit me really when playing the game. The initial thought was oh my God, there's so much. I'm so jealous. And then I was oh my God, there's so much. That must have been so much work as well. What did you know about the game when you first started on it? Because you were on it right from the start, Philip, right? So were you literally from step one?
I started about, I think it was 6 months after the rest of the team had actually started. When I came in, coming from DICE and kind of a slightly different company, very big, of course, very planned in all kinds of...
very different style of games going on there as well.
Yeah, definitely. And with that huge legacy from all the other games, I came to Hazelight with starting from scratch, basically. no audio engine, no nothing, no real like knowledge about even Wise or Unreal or anything like that. So it was pretty crazy in the beginning. And I remember actually like having one of these like show and tell, or kind of, you know, we looked at the game in the state that it was at that time, together with a lot of other people at Hazelight. And I just like sat there having the cold sweat in the sofa.
No pressure, buddy. This is all on you.
Oh my God. It was so much stuff. And also Joseph Farris, creative director and also the founder and owner of Hazelight, he doesn't like repetition much. You can see that pretty quickly. And so, yeah, he was just talking about like, oh, we could add this and we could add that. And I was like, holy shit.
The sweat like, just pouring. Like, yeah, sure. Yeah.
You know, like some parts of this game, like you play things for like maybe 5 or 15 minutes or something. If you're like at least like kind of just following the main path of the game, and you could actually use that feature or that ability for like an entire level or perhaps even an entire game if you would like to. But it's a lot of variation. So to get back to like where we started was like gathering the team and finding like planning everything, and also finding what tool we would use to basically integrate our sound with was a big task. But then when Anne-Sophie joined, that was basically when we started the sound production. So we took a really small part of the game, a pretty linear part as well, and just like kind of sat down and started making the sounds. And we didn't really have like much direction, or I didn't have. We basically like sort of shaped it together. I felt like we had another understanding, even like without talking to each other, we had an understanding of what we wanted to do with the game and with the sound. And of course, that was like developed during the process and also with talking to one another and finding sounds and so on. But yeah, we basically did that small part, and I felt at least personally that we kind of nailed the like playful style and the variety and the sort of scale very quickly, actually. And I remember also showing this to our creative director, and he was like, are you sure you can keep this, like, you know, level of quality up for the rest of the game? And we were like kind of shaking and being unsure, but we were like, yes, we can do that. So one of the things that we've done like through the entire production and with like the Hazelight audio team is like we have very high goals. And even though we've been under time pressure, we are like, some of us are kind of like quite junior, some of us have worked on different things and also like new to the studio and to, you know, all the tools and everything, we still set like incredibly high goals for ourselves. And I'm really proud of that, to be on such a team.
Yeah, and it must have been a phenomenal amount to even plan and lay out. Where do you even begin? I mean, when did you have the idea of how big the game was going to be and how many areas and levels there were going to be? Was it quite early on, or did you kind of have to keep scoping up every time a new level came in?
I would say that it was constantly kind of changing a little bit, but it was actually like, I was very impressed about that as well with Hazelight. When I came in, so the rest of the game team, they had worked on it for like about 6 months, and they were very good at like kind of blocking out the levels. So you were kind of able to see at least like, okay, you know, like this level will be ish this big, it will include these things. There were a lot of things actually already like not so far from, like, I wouldn't say finished, but you could see what it was.
Yeah.
And understand how it was going to go down. So planning was basically a constant thing that I did throughout the entire project. But very quickly, we also sat down with the rest of the audio team, and we worked very much like level per level, even sub-level per sub-level, because some of the sub-levels are like, you know, 1.5 hours long. If you play it like quite fast, you could probably spend like 2 hours in them. But that was kind of our approach. Do you have anything to add there as well on that?
Yeah, you mentioned the level per level, like this idea of vertical slice. It's a kind of game that has so much content that you can't just, you know, look at the whole and say, oh, I'm going to add a sound here and a sound there and hope for the best kind of thing. Like, we had to rely on good planning. And that's what we did. That's, you know, what Philip explained. We divided it per level and we knew with that, you know, process, how much time we had basically to dedicate to all these different sections of the game. So we took it, you know, one day at a time, one week at a time, one level at a time, and went from there. And I think that turned out pretty well because we had some sort of margin to adjust there if there was content that was added or removed even and things like that.
I felt like also one of the things, like, we had to be quite strict with like how much time we spent on each sound and each feature and so on. So like we started with basically like that small section of the game. And then straight after that, we went on to create or have our own like vertical slice. And the rest of the game team, they didn't care about that pretty much at all. They just kept on going. But it felt like we needed to kind of prove to ourselves that we had the tech that we needed, that the sounds were high quality enough, and that we had all the different components and everything. So we actually worked for like 2 months on that vertical slice. And whilst we were making sound, me and Anne-Sophie, the technical team that was basically just Joachim, our technical sound designer, he basically had to learn like how to code during this time and create our like ambience system, reverb system, all of these things at the same time. So when we sort of finished that vertical slice, we had like at least the key pillars of what we needed in terms of like tech. And we also had music and sound effects. We had Foley. We had like all the things so that we could already start like testing out mixing, using Wise in the way that we wanted to do, build all the structures and everything. So it was like really crucial, I think, that we did that and took that time to prove to ourselves that we could do this. And then after that, we basically went on to another level that had different abilities, different functionality, and, you know, like different gameplay.
It's almost a different game per level, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. And then we, of course, saw that like, oh, shit, like, you know, we need to add this. But it made it like kind of tangible because we just did it for like a small section at a time. And we actually kept on working like that for the rest of the project. We never like separated the audio team in like, okay, Anne-Sophie, you are the specialist of like that, and I am the specialist of this. We worked as a group, and I think that was a really good decision. And it's one of the like things that we have brought up after the project as well, that many people like that in the audio team. We really stayed like a family, like a force team, you know, like
nice.
A strike team. And especially since we were so new as well and hadn't worked with each other at all, it was really good to like, you know, socially get to learn who you are as a person, what you're good at, and all of these things. So as Anne-Sophie said, with like the collaboration and the teamwork, that really like kind of inspired and made it work really well.
Yeah, nice. And I have so many questions about all the levels and everything, but I can't go any further without mentioning the biggest kind of question, which must have introduced so many different thought processes and challenges, which is the fact that it's split screen.
Of course. So the elephant in the room.
Yes, right. Like, we have to talk about this because you did keep the quality bar up. It was really, really nice. You towed the line very well between quality along with that kind of comedic fun style. But the split screen thing, all the time I'm thinking, right, I have to find out how they handled this, because how do you handle it? Because you have two people playing who can be in two different parts of the level completely. How did you even begin to tackle that?
As soon as I started at Hazelight and I knew that we were going to do a split screen game, of course, it was like, that was another stress, you know, like, how the hell do we figure this out? But I had a few ideas, just like very, very simple, I feel like in the beginning, at least, like just to, so if one player is in like, you know, one environment, having like one quad ambience playing and the other character is in another room, we would basically like kind of split the 5.1 mix at least, and basically lower like the two channels that are on on the right side if you're the left player, and vice versa. So we could kind of, wanted to kind of blend between them a little bit and just like do like volume automation basically if you're in two different spaces. But that was like just the first step. So when we started with that, like, you know, I thought that split screen was going to be like kind of easy in some sort of way. But every time we had a new idea about like, oh, let's do this, this will work really well. And I have figured out like all the issues that this could cause, but I have solved all of them. And then the first thing someone says is like, yeah, but have you thought about that? And it's like, oh, no, we haven't. So that was like the constant kind of...
And so it begins.
Yeah, exactly. The constant process with like split screen. But we really, in couch co-op, when you play in the same room on the same like screen, the game is very often played in a vertical split visually. So we basically split the 5.1 mix in two halves. And then we let the left side of the mix and the left character's perspective also bleed over a little bit to the right so that we still get like a stereo, because we didn't, of course, want to start making a game in like two mono mixes, basically. Other things that we did as well was like we had the reverbs, and we panned those reverbs a little bit to a different side as well. We have some real-time or a runtime, I should say, delay systems. And then the left character has like a little bit of the center and the right speaker, and then like the left and the rear left speaker. So like kind of just, you know, putting these sounds in these different halves worked pretty well. And was something that we did with basically like all the sounds, you could say. We also actually did way less spatialization than you usually do in a single player game, which is of course super beautiful, and we would have loved to do that, but it just didn't really work. Like, the immersion was harmed by too much spatialization. So most of the like player abilities and also like potential vehicles or things that they interact with, we basically just like put them in one position and like choose where they should go at all times. We had basically a parameter that we could control. So we do one type of panning or one positioning in speakers and one in headphones, because if we would start panning things too hard in headphones, it basically just made you like flip over on your chair. So that was like one of the things at least. But we, in general, we did kind of the same thing, but just like slightly less in headphones.
On top of that, we can add that our sound design itself, you know, we had to consider that, okay, if we sound design everything, if everything is audible at all times, it's just going to be really messy.
Yeah.
So there's some choices that we had to do there. And I think that, you know, our goal was always, you know, okay, let's make sure that everything is clear and clean, and we know what's important at what time. I think with that kind of direction, it worked out pretty well, but not only for clarity, but in the end, when I play the game, I feel like sound has become very useful to guide the player's attention, both players' attention, to whatever, you know, the gameplay tells us is important. Like, you know, there's this huge explosion and it's like, I don't care if, you know, it happens on the left side of the screen and you're the right player. Perhaps it's interesting for you too, you know? So through those, you know, sound design strategies of like really emphasizing on what we believe is the most important thing, we say, hey, look at that. Don't care about the rest. And it kind of becomes a clear mix through that. It's been really helpful.
Yeah. I would say that like our mixes, Sounds of it says, like quite drastic when it comes to like change. You go from room to room, or like small section to small section, and the soundscape and the sort of sound story really like progresses quite fast and quite abruptly in some cases as well, which kind of tickles me in a nice way, because it makes it like a little bit more like cinematic in a way. Like, you know, a trailer sound mix is like one thing at a time, but a really cool like sort of sequence of different sounds, instead of having a little bit of everything all the time. So I remember when me and Anne-Sophie were mixing the game, we were like sometimes battling a little bit like what is important at the right moment. But we were both like in the end, like really quite drastic when it came like, okay, you know, screw that sound. Like this is, you know, what is cool at the moment. And I think that that works also quite well with that playful style in some sort of way, because we don't have to make everything like so realistic in a way.
Yeah, exactly. The style is very Pixar-ish, right? It's very Toy Story slash Wall-E kind of approach in terms of the fun factor, but also the kind of aesthetic of the whole thing.
Yeah.
It must have been, I got to talk about the recording sessions, right? I've got to, because I've seen the video.
Of course.
Man. Yeah. I've seen the video you did with Jen, like the 101. It looked like so much fun, and not just because Philip takes his pants off, but which is going to give everyone enough reason to go and watch it now anyway.
Oh, yes.
So there's so much, especially when I mentioned there's whips going on, but there's so much in that video that looked so much fun. Like there was the underwater recordings, there was the whip recordings, the kind of boom roarers, you made your own kazoos. Tell me more about this.
We knew when we played the tree level and the wasp nest level that we were going to need like a whole lot of buzzing and wing flaps and like just that, you know, library sounds were not going to cut it, you know. We had to come up with like our own material, our own source material and a lot of it and varied content and of different sizes and textures and whatnot, because there are many sort of variations on those wasp enemies and swarms and such. So we were like, okay, let's take the full day, you know, and record anything that you can sort of flap in front of a microphone and, or, you know, make a buzz sound with. So we, built a bull roarer. So, you know, with like two planks of wood and I think we added a bit of paper somewhere in the middle and you strap that, at the end of a rope and you swing it as fast as you can and it makes like fluttery kind of, buzz sound. So we used that. We used also, yeah, the homemade kazoos. I looked it up online and I was like, okay, how do you make it? I can't go buy a kazoo now. And also it's going to be more interesting if it's a little bit homemade. So how do we do it? And, you know, look it up. It's like super easy with popsicle sticks and some paper and some rubber bands. And then you get a few different kinds of buzzing and you just blow that into a microphone and it works pretty well.
Yeah, it sounded better than an actual kazoo, to be honest.
Yeah. And I really like, seriously, I went to the like office kitchen and I just, you know, grabbed whatever I could find. So if you even put a little bit of time and effort into it, I'm sure you can make some pretty damn cool kazoos actually.
Yeah, I love sound design for that, when all your colleagues are just looking at you and they're like, what are you doing?
It's the best to share these videos with people at work as well. They love it. And it's so fun to share, you know, the crazy stuff that we do as sound designers. And also to like, you know, not be so pretentious about it. Just like, you know, this is what we do. Like, it looks absolutely ridiculous.
And it's a fun opportunity to discover a new interest. Like when we did the whip recordings, Philip got a little bit excited.
Oh, yeah.
He went and bought like the longest whip he could possibly find online. I had real issue like trying to crack it, you know. And then not only that, but he was like, that's not quite enough. Now I need to actually make my own whip from scratch. So he did some research and built the whip, even gave it a name.
Yeah. The white dragon.
You're very attached to this whip, Philip.
Oh yeah, I am. It's really nice actually. And it's super simple. It's like a bit of tape, a bit of rope, a few like kind of I don't know what they are called, but like small chains with like some weights.
Mm.
Yeah. And it works like a charm. It really cracks well. So
nice.
For all of you who need like, you know, some stuff to do IRs or whatever, just build your own.
Yeah, I was going to say it's great for the IRs.
Yeah, definitely. Just look out because they are like classified as knives when you go outside with them. So
what?
Yeah. So you can't really like have them anywhere.
They're classified as knives.
Yeah. They go under the same kind of law.
I hardly think it's just as quick, you know, to...
No, not really. I don't think so.
And the range.
But it hurts like, I don't know what, when you hit yourself. Oof, it's terrible.
Yeah, yeah. It takes me back to being a kitchen porter back in the days and when the chefs used to kind of like have the wet tea towel. Yeah. I'm sure it's like 1,000 times worse. So there was also the classic, of course, some slime. Can't go without some slime. I think every sound designer wants some slime in their repertoire.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
That must have been fun. And what was your highlight out of all of these little fun nuggets of sound design and recordings?
The Wasp session was really fun.
Yeah,
it
was a lot of fun. Just to add one thing to that one as well, was like, Joseph again, he had bought this massage gun or yeah. like pistol. It's like a vibrator kind of apparatus, but quite violently, not used for pleasure. and we just like kind of realized that, oh, that one was like just lying about in the studio because people used it to like, you know, get their stiff necks to be loosened up again. And so we just took that one and it had three intensities with like speed as well. And we just started like vibrating on some plastic and we realized like, this is really cool. It just made this like really low frequency.
Nice.
So we basically recorded like, you know, a handful of different like kinds of plastic and paper and whatnot and vibrated with these three different intensities. And that is like one of the main elements for these wasp wings in the game. And it was so easy for me to just make these sounds because I just basically made like 10-second loops with different intensities. So when they are idling, it's the lowest. Medium is when they are flying, and then high when they are attacking.
Amazing.
So it can be quite simple sometimes, but it took us a whole day before we found that massage gun and basically started with that. But it's then I layered it with all these other kazoos and all the flapping and everything that we did. But the sort of fundamental thing is that that massage gun.
Mm. And then we use our voices a whole lot as well.
Yeah.
At least I did the... Perhaps you remember the evil baking doll. I think we called it the toy crusher in the dungeon section. That's sort of crushing after the players when they're running. And like she has this evil laugh and that's me.
Ah, nice. So you're the one with the most evil laugh in the company. That must be what it is.
Yeah. Exactly. And the flying sort of animal under the tree, kind of whale looking, and it's definitely whale sounding. That's also mostly my voice. And even the little fuse, when you start the game and in the shed in the very beginning, and you have to run around like looking for fuses because it's like the tutorial part of the game.
Yeah.
And those little fuses are like, they're taunting you and like, and like this kind of little sound. And that's also my voice. So it's in plenty of places.
Yeah, I also recorded my voice for a few things, quite unconventional things, but also I made the voice for this creature after this baking doll that is just like some sort of toy that is chasing you, just some growls and stuff.
Nice.
That was quite fun. One of my favorites was definitely the underwater recording session. It was like just, you know, one day of fun stuff. And we also got to borrow two Aquarian
hydrophones.
Yeah, from Pole Position production. And they sound so good. So that one was really cool. And basically the whole water level is just like made from our own underwater recordings.
Amazing.
So that felt like also like kind of similar with the Wasp recording, like a really good investment, if you say, in time. Like we took some time to record these things, but then it really pays off because you can basically get to work straight away and you have the right source that you need. So I feel like, we did some smart recording sessions. And then we ran around in Stockholm and just recorded all kinds of IRs as well, whipping about. And even though they are considered like the same...
Scaring the locals.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, the thing is that I recorded quite a lot around in Stockholm. And sometimes people look at you like very weird, especially when recording some like VLF. I don't know if you know what that is.
Oh, wow.
But I built my own hula hoop microphone. It's basically a very low frequency like antenna, and I sat with that one in the tube. People looked like really weird.
You have to be brave to be a sound designer sometimes, you know?
Like, yeah, you do. But when me and Anne-Sophie went out with the whip, people were like really impressed and they liked it. I was like a little bit afraid that they would be annoyed at us for making these loud sounds, but they were like actually just, wow, oh, are you whipping? So that was kind of, you know, a different...
Getting an audience.
Yeah, exactly. So that was also fun.
Yeah, and there's something to be said. So, I mean, obviously sound libraries are very important sometimes and very, very useful. But there's a different sort of feeling when you've captured your own source.
Definitely.
Right? It kind of feels not only more personal, but you have what you want. And it's just a different feeling of satisfaction afterwards, right? When it's in the game and you hear it and you're like, do you know what? I remember that day and I remember getting all this stuff.
Absolutely.
And putting it in. It's just a whole other level.
You're so right. Like, and it, you know that it's going to sound like no other game because it's your own sound and no one else has it. And it's, that's what makes it so beautiful, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. It's also like you can really perform it for like how you want it to sound or what kind of movement and stuff. Like, sound libraries are excellent. I would never like work without them. But when you're performing for like a loop, for example, I feel like some loops that you find are like loopable sounds basically in your sound libraries, they might be quite static and like, you know, not so interesting. But when you perform it yourself, you can really get that variation in and the life in the loop, which is needed for it not to sound dull.
Yeah, exactly. Now, in terms of going to switch focus now to the dialogue. So there's quite a lot of dialogue in the game as well. So that must have taken quite a lot of planning and like sorting out with the voice actors because you have your own in-house mocap studio, correct?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah. So how was that process, like getting the actors in, but also miking them up during that? And then I assume you had to get them back for all the in-game instances as well?
Yeah. So it was mostly taken care of by our VO designer, Greg Stankovic, who's excellent. And he, as you said, had a lot to do. that's for sure. But he did an excellent job. So he was very involved in both the mocap sessions where we recorded the cutscenes and with the recording sessions that we did at Side for their in-game voices. But also another thing that kind of makes it all more complex is that the same actor who plays Cody actually plays Hakim as well.
Oh, wow.
So that meant that we had to do a lot of ADR as well for the cutscenes. So we couldn't basically just like do one recording and then be... You know, we had all the VO that we needed. We also had to always get Hakim's voice added on top of the actual acting in the scene. So that was a big task. And also to make the Hakim character, you know, come to life and feel like, you know, the acting of the voice and the body actually fits like one thing. He, of course, had to spend a lot of time like micro adjusting things here and there, and which I think he did a really good job at. But it, of course, takes time and feeling and, you know, iterations and so on. So it was a big job. But yeah, we worked with Side. So unfortunately, we weren't able to actually go to UK to record with our actors so often since COVID-19 happened. So that was quite a big risk for us as well. It was like, oh, like, will we be able to ship? Because we might not be able to record.
I can imagine, yeah.
But in the end, we managed. So I would say that the biggest hit that we in the audio team took with COVID was actually this delay in like recording sessions with the actors, but we managed in the end. But it needed a few really long days and hard hours in the end. But yeah, so he basically took care of that. I helped him out a little bit with more like VO mixing and also some traditional dialogue editing. But we also got some help from Red Pipe when it came to the cutscene dialogue. So they actually mixed those and took that off our plates. And then me and him, we also worked quite closely on the VO processing for the different bosses and some characters and so on, which was a lot of fun, actually. We had some fun times in the studio making those processing chains and so on.
Yeah, I can imagine, because as great as the kind of natural dialogue is, the big bosses and things must have been so much fun.
Yeah, especially since they are also like kind of playful. So you could really, like if you're playing with like a younger person and you're like a parent or an older person, we could actually like sort of hint to some classics or some fun stuff that you will recognize, but not your your companion who might be younger and just see the fun of it. So that was something that we tried to do, and we weren't really afraid of doing those things. I would also like to say that like one of the coolest things with the VO is actually the writing and the acting. Like we had really talented actors that made it very playful and humorous. Greg was very involved in the writing as well, and like was able to tweak it to the gameplay scenarios and to the game. So that's really like made not only like well recorded VO and it plays in the right place, but they actually say the right thing. And that, of course, makes a huge difference. So that was cool.
Amazing. Yeah, I mean, it's a good thing that you highlight about saying the right things at the right time. A big shout out to voice designers out there as well, VO designers, because it's a role that doesn't often come up on the show, I have to admit. And it's a kind of an undersung role, I believe.
Yeah, unfortunately it is. But it's still, as you say, like one of the key pillars of like information in the game, story, like how you emotionally connect to the characters or to the game. So it's super important. And also, yeah, like one of the key pillars of just like, you know, sound coming out of the speakers that need to be well mixed and well recorded to not bring you out of the immersion or not fit with the rest of the sounds or the music. So it's definitely important to give it some love, basically.
Yeah, definitely. And speaking of the music, that's a whole other thing I wanted to dive into you as well, because you were working with Christopher, wasn't it?
Yeah.
From Elias Software.
Yeah.
And so did you use Elias when implementing the music?
No, we did not actually. We basically worked with him as a composer only. So we used Wise's music system for this game. And it was also like neither me or Anne-Sophie like made any music, but we did most of the sort of finalizing mix with the music and so on. And again, we worked very much as a group. So when we had these, we called them sprints, when we basically took like one part of the game and built it up, it was very important to us that that both Christopher and Gustav were in the room. We had spotting sessions together so that we could talk genre and the direction and instrumentation and where music was going to be important and where sound was going to be important. And then we collaborated with them a lot. Gustav was like kind of the specialist in like the puzzle music, and Christopher took care of some of the other sort of big chunks of the music, but they still worked really closely, shared sounds and even like, you know, melodies or small little things like all the time, and also added things to their individual music piece. So it was like, you know, Christopher needed some, I don't know, arpeggios from Gustav, and Gustav needed some drums from Christopher. So it was a lot of like juggling around with like different music and just getting it to the right end result.
So it sounds like you were both quite involved with the music side as well then. So it wasn't, you know, sometimes you can just get the music kind of thrown over from the composers and then you put it in the game. But it sounds like you had quite a nice back and forth and got to be quite involved in the usage of the music.
Yeah, for sure. I would say so. Even though we didn't like sort of practically have anything to do with it in like the composing way, we were still very involved. That's also another thing that I think worked really well with these sprints was that we usually worked for like 6 weeks on one level or one section that we decided. And during that time, it was really hard for Gustav and Christopher because they had to write basically completely new music every time. But we, in the end, we had sound effects like ambiences, we had some abilities, we had music, we had all the components so that we could actually sort of premix every section of the game after that. And we could also like iterate on the music like really quickly because we realized something in the mix and so on. So that was a really fun process and valuable to us.
And what about the implementation side? You've said you've used Wise. First of all, was there a kind of main reason that you chose Wise over the native Unreal stuff and kind of went that way rather than kind of design your own stuff within Unreal?
Yeah, so during A Way Out, Gustav and Måns and Lovisa, amongst some other people who shipped that game or made the sound for that game, they used Unreal. But we saw some limitations with it. And also Anne-Sophie and Joachim, they are like specialists, at least according to me. I was like, you know, I have never used Wise before. I've used like Frostbite, and I came to Hazelight and I had no idea what Wise was. I had just heard about it. So they basically like taught me Wise. And both of them were like, you know, we will use Wise. Like they knew that it was going to be really good. So I basically trusted them. And I feel like, you know, you can make really nice sound in Wise, basically.
Yeah.
So it's a good tool.
And so I can imagine that you brought a lot of your kind of like Wise history with you in terms of the implementation side of this.
Oh, definitely. But I want to still go back onto the sort of teamwork theme of this podcast, because it's like yes, absolutely, we all brought in our set of like skill sets and expertise, and I had worked with Wise before, so of course that helped us to sort of get started and like break the ice with it a little bit. But I mean, Philip has been like super autonomous with learning as well and taking it even further, you know due to the split screen and the needs of our game. There were so many things that, you know, I never needed to explore before. So I think it's been something that we did as a team to dive into Wise as a tool and in Unreal, and that combination of technical solutions and how we could make that serve us as best as possible. So so yeah, for me, I mean, I of course had some instincts and reflexes with Wise, but that was really just a basis, and then we went from there and like took it way further and shaped it to our needs.
Yeah, but I still feel like something that Anne-Sophie and Joachim had at least in the beginning was like this, you know. They were so like fluent in like Wise, so they could just do stuff. Whilst I was like
the Wise whisperers.
Yeah, I was bashing my head against the table and just like, Anne-Sophie, why doesn't this work? And I'm also like not always the easiest person to work with, to be honest. And I have very sort of set ideas of like structure and how things should work. Sometimes we joke about my brain that it's like a single core processor. It can't do more than that, which is probably quite true, to be honest. But so I remember like one of the first things that I started with in Wise was to set up the bus structure and some other structures, because I felt like that was something that was like so important to me, that I could feel fluent in like the ways that we used Wise, at least that it was really just like, you know, straightforward, like, oh, this sound, okay, I will mix it here, okay, that. So it was also very good to me to actually sit and be a little bit frustrated, because it made me learn it a lot faster as well. But so now I also feel a little bit more fluent, but I think they still have expertise, knowledge in it.
And what would you say was one of your, I want to say proudest moments, but in terms of the implementation, what was the kind of thing that you were like, do you know what? We nailed it there. That's pretty awesome.
I think I have two things that I think about. Like, many things are really cool, actually, but the music level, the last level in the game with the Maze singing ability is one of the coolest moments, I think. And which was also, again, like collaboration between sound effects, music, and the technical stuff, and all of us, basically. And that was to start with that, actually, like that was the last level that we also worked on before we kind of had like a little bit of time to do a second pass and start mixing. But we had kind of left that one because we knew that it was going to be really difficult. But we still, I at least felt like, you know, this is our time to shine with like the music and the sound effects. But it made me really nervous because it was like, how do we solve this like in a nice way? You know, it's like, it's so complex.
And did it come from your team or did it come from another department?
It came from another department. It was basically like, you know, from the start, like Joseph's idea of the game always had a music level in it.
Nice.
So we knew about it from the start. Of course, like the, you know, some of the mechanics might have been iterated upon a little bit and sure. All the parts, but it was there from the start, really. So we always knew about it. But I think that, first of all, I actually think that we made it really nice. I'm super proud of what we managed to do.
Yeah, I'm trying to talk to you about this and avoiding complete spoilers here at the same time. So we're just kind of vaguing to the, all the audience here. Just being like, just make sure you play it to the final level.
Definitely. So. and it was like really important that it became musical as well. And we started like really, really complex. Me and Joachim, we actually started singing and like prototyping this feature together. And we wanted to make a sampler, like we wanted to sample a singer and have like, you know, all the variety and complexity and and have the voice being like a synth, basically, that we could control. So we started doing this, but we quickly realized, like, with some Excel sheet work that it was going to be, like, you know, up to, like, 5,000 assets. Because, of course, we needed variations and all of that. And we had actually, like, talked to Christopher and Gustav as well and said that, okay, for this level, you can only use one key. You can use it in major and minor, but you can use only one key so that we at least locked down that. But it became so much, like, having three variations of start, three variations of loops, three variations of release, and also glissandos between each and every note in the scale, like both up and down.
Yeah, my mind's already boggling at the sheer amount.
Exactly. Yeah, it's madness. And then also we wanted to, because they have like kind of different genres, we wanted the like kind of rock level to have more like yay, and the classic level to be oh. So different actual like kind of genres within the sampler as well. But then instead we built this like quite simple we just play a singing track with the rest of the music. And since our game is quite linear, we always go into like a new music trigger, a new music track playing. So we never get to repetition, really. And built a really fancy like volume slider instead, where it's like it fades up as soon as you press the button, but then we take care of the fading out part, because that was a little bit ugly from the start. It was like, if you have too many like short notes and like kind of fading out in that, it became very obvious that this is actually like something looping in the background. But Joachim made this system where we just like, we have a MIDI track where Gustav and Christopher could make a melody for the singer to perform. And also then we just parse those MIDI notes and make markers. And then I could even actually go into those markers and decide that, like, okay, these markers you cannot stop, but on that marker you can stop. So I could, we basically did this like automated step, but then we could also go in and change those numbers a little bit. So, and we actually did. And then, yeah, it works really nice, actually. And we also recorded a dubbed track so that when May is actually affecting something in the environment, we fade in a little bit of that dub to make it like sound even more sort of magical and nice. The singer, Sanya, Christopher's wife, she could perform really well. And I must say she did it like... I feel so emotional always when I see the last part of the game and with her singing, it's my cry is up here.
Awesome.
I can say that one of the things I'm most proud in terms of like, yeah, sounds and implementation is all the worldizing aspect of the game. And again, that's really been teamwork. Like, it's a lot of Philip's vision in terms of how it should be, as much like the sort of ambient system and how to manage those, you know, ambient zone and stuff, up to the runtime delay reflections, to, you know, the reverb and the convolution reverb that we use and how all that should work. And then Joachim and our technical designers have like sort of made that happen, made that work. And me, as a designer, of course, you know, contribute to for input and stuff, but use those system to basically bring that world to life. And the result of it is like, you know, with the whip that we recorded for our impulse responses that we designed and created ourselves and used for, you know, for creating unique environments in the game. Plus, yeah, those delay reflections, I think, really bring the world to life. And, you know, in combination with all the ambiences were really like my baby in this game. Like, I really enjoyed the really crafting those, like, how the world is supposed to sound, kind of. So just standing in a space, like I mentioned earlier about, like, choosing which sounds to include and not making everything sound. That means, like, you know, it's not busy, like, in terms of sound, in terms of soundscape. And that's deliberate because we don't want it to be busy. We don't want it to be chaotic or messy or confusing. So that means that the sounds that are there, they need to contribute to make the whole world come to life. And that happens through, like, worldizing them and make them sound like they really come from that place. And I think we did a pretty damn good job at that, actually.
Mm. Yeah, that was also something that we sort of quickly realized with Joseph's vision, because he actually didn't give us much direction either. It was more like he actually trusted our intuition and our ability to create this game. So he never really like spoke to us except for saying that things were good, which was super nice. I was actually quite worried about that in the beginning. Like, oh shit, like, will he, you know, sit behind me and like basically tell me what to do all the time? But he's super fun to work with. And he also likes when it feels like immersive in some sort of way. And it felt like he really wanted that sort of grounded style, still with like all the fun things, but still ground it and feel it like you're in the picture in some sort of way. And that also like was something that we wanted to do. So it was very nice to be on the same frequency with him.
I mean, it's similar to if you watch a Pixar movie, like the latest Pixar movies, they have absolutely beautiful, you know, ambiences and world sounds, and you believe it, you really believe it. And of course, on top of that, they have that playfulness of the animated style. So it was a bit of a goal there to go for that same kind of atmosphere.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to go as far as like you did kind of capture that kind of quality bar, in my opinion, because the subtleties in the ambiences and the foley and everything, it's the believable thing, right? It's believability that we're going for, because it's not realistic, because obviously it's not realistic. But the believability of the world that you created, and the same with Pixar movies, it's like those small moments really kind of sell it and really hammer it.
Yeah,
on. That's awesome.
One thing actually that I could add as well was like, you know, you could maybe think that UI sounds and some of these other like kind of non-diegetic elements, we tried doing the more like synth style, but it also felt like it didn't really glue with the rest in a way. So
you wanted something more tactile.
Yeah, exactly. And like, even though it might sound like you would have created with a synth, it was still like it had some sort of like, it wasn't, you know, just sort of layer on top of the other sounds. They went a little bit further into the mix in some sort of way. So yeah, everything is like very tactile and a little bit of like ground and dirt under the fingernails.
Yes, definitely. Now, speaking of the mix, you know, you touched on it again in this Genlec video that you weren't really sitting in the sweet spot because two of you had to play at the same time, right? So that must have been fun and also very interesting to try and mix with two people playing.
Yeah, definitely. Super fun. I mean, when you've been working on this game for nearly 2 years and you've played it over and over again, but at the end, you know, you're mixing it and everything is in there and you sit there, two of you, and you still laugh while playing, you know, you still have fun, you enjoy it. I think that says a lot.
Have to remember you're working.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. No, but that makes the process really fun and also really dynamic. And again, it's that teamwork, right? It's not one of us sitting there making those decisions. It's the two of us playing, saying, does that feel right? Should this be louder? Should this be quieter? Yes or no? You know, it's always a discussion, and in the best possible way. Like, it's really, it becomes like basically just two pairs of ears instead of one. And that makes it more reliable, I think.
Yeah.
And also, it's one of those things that's more common in cinema as well, right? To have multiple people in the mixing stage.
Yeah.
So it's not as common in games, but it's done even more so in films, and kind of make sense for games, right?
Definitely.
Because you're both experiencing, you're both playing, or even one of you playing would still sort of make sense to me.
Yeah.
You know, that you have that collaborative mix going on. So it must have been great to be kind of like, I'm not sure about this. What about you? You know, actually, I kind of like it. Or it's not important right now, really, I guess, you know, and have all these discussions, which must have made it more of a kind of rewarding process alongside it.
Definitely. And I feel like one of the things that you mentioned was like, you know, when you're not like 100% sure, like, is it too loud or is it too low or is this nice or is this nice?
Yeah.
We could really like just ask each other. And I trust Anne-Sophie's ears 110%. And I hope she trusts mine, but maybe more around 90%, I think.
That's where the 10% went.
Yeah, exactly. And we wanted to create also like this very, as we said before, like kind of drastic and impactful mix. But I maybe sometimes take it to like 6 dB, whilst Anne-Sophie would have taken it to 3. So it was kind of good that then we decided like, okay, 4 is enough.
Compromise.
Exactly. So I think it was, as you say, like really fun. And also I know that it made the mix better that we both sat there. And I really would have liked also to involve the rest of the team more in the mix. They really helped out as well. But unfortunately, we had COVID-19 and they were home. We were lucky that we were able to be in our studios at Hazelight. Mm. But it's like, as you say, like you, as a gamer, and when you play a game, you hear it with different ears, you think different things are important. And that, like when you mix a film, you will, of course, you will see it with different eyes and also listen to it with different ears, but it's still like one linear thing. But a game can be perceived in so many different ways, and people can think that one thing is more interesting than another. And you can play the same sequence like 10,000 times and it will always at least be slightly different. So I think it's really crucial to invite everyone in the mix process, because you just get like more kind of facts that like, okay, this happens a little bit too early, or this happened for me, or, you know, I think that this is cool and I think that that is cool. And of course, in the end, you have to boil it down to like one decision. You can't do like 10,000 mixes of the game. But I think it's really valuable with everyone's ideas and sort of feelings. And something that I would like to do more in the future. We were just like not able to do it this time, also due to time reasons. It was like we needed to fix bugs at the same time as mixing. And then it was just like, okay, you know, me and Anne-Sophie just had to sit and mix a lot.
How long did the mix take you in the end?
So I would say that we started basically mixing the first day we started the project, to be honest.
That's true.
Getting in there early.
Yeah, that's also something that I really strongly believe is like, you have to mix all the time. Like otherwise, we wouldn't have been able to get feedback from Joseph. We wouldn't have been able to like really know if the music was correct or if the Foley was too loud or, you know, all of these things. And also to just like add new things in there into the mix. I feel like you need to mix what is actually there as good as it can be all the time. Then in the end, it was like, I felt like we had a very, very good base. And then it was more like making it more impactful in one way, like a little bit more linear mixing. Like, okay, you know, at this checkpoint, let's bring this down a little bit. At that checkpoint, let's bring this up a little bit. So yeah, I would say like we mixed for 2 years. But
as one long mix.
Yeah, but I think like the final mix we had like about a month.
Something like that. It was pretty much the time it took for us to play the game like in every possible combination. So like us sitting in the same room, us playing over network in different rooms, us playing in headphones, us playing in stereo, us playing in 5.1, you know, all those combinations in like the full game as well. So I guess you need a couple of weeks to do that.
Yeah, I remember in the planning, it was something like that. And whilst the mixing, we were, of course, also finding issues with things. We were like really on the, you know, the last day when we were done, but it turned out well. And I think that we were like lucky that we got as much as we did time to mix it, and that we were also smart to try to, like, you know, always try to mix after each sprint or after each bigger section and after, like, each new iteration on a system or whatever it could have been that actually impacted the sound in some way, we mixed. I remember, though, one thing. Oh, it was so crazy. I made some mistake with, like, some sidechaining. So instead of sidechaining, like, lowering volumes of certain elements when the dialogue was playing, when there was signal on that bus, I did it the opposite way. So it was like, it lowered when they were silent. And we mixed, like, you know, it took like a week, say, and did some sort of like pre-mixing pass, like quite early, just to like get to that stage where, like, oh, you know, things are working. And then I realized, like, oh no, I have done this mistake. Everything will be affected by this.
You had to change everything.
Yeah, it wasn't as big of a deal as I, you know, initially thought, but like, oh, I felt so stupid. And it was just this silly little mistake, like one RTPC that was basically like turned the other way around.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but... I felt like I fixed it in an afternoon or something like that. It wasn't that big of a deal, but it felt hard when I found it.
I can imagine that first initial moment as well when you're like, oh no.
Yeah. Like, Joachim, is there anything we can script to fix this or like automatically change this? Oh, no, it wasn't that easy. But
and my final question to you both is, if you could go back in time to the beginning of the project, what advice would you give to yourself?
Don't be so stressed and nervous about everything. Just, you know, roll with it. It will go fine. Like, you don't have to be nervous all the time.
It's a really good question. It's not really something that I didn't do, but I would definitely tell myself and the other members of the team, just trust each other. We did. We definitely did from the start, I would say, but it's something that I think has been like really key, really essential. And if I have to, you know, give that advice to any other team out there as well, it's just like trust each other, like, and rely on each other's skill set and build something together. Yeah.
Amazing. Well, I think that's a fantastic note to leave it on. And I'm very sad to be saying goodbye, but it's been an absolute pleasure having you on the show. And I hope you've had as much fun as I have.
Definitely.
Oh, yeah.
I want to thank Anne-Sophie Mongeau and Philip Eriksson one more time. And I want to thank everyone for listening. Thanks for joining me today, both.
Thank you so much.
Whoa, this is surreal.
Surreal, but fun.
Hey, everyone, this is Sam. Thanks very much for listening to the Sound Architect podcast today. I hope you enjoyed this episode. If so, there are many ways you can support the show, which is incredibly appreciated. Obviously, there's the financial way where you can support us on Patreon, which is patreon.com/sounddesignuk. However, there are many other ways which also help, such as liking, subscribing, reviewing, commenting, and sharing via whatever channel you listen on. Thanks so much for your support already. It really is a work of passion for me, and I'd love to keep sharing the knowledge from all these talented and wonderful people. Thanks again, and catch you on the next episode.